following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is, and it's a Friday. Once again, we made it here. You know, when this whole stay-at-home order suggestion began, I was counting the weeks like it was going to end anytime in the conceivable future. We're not so lucky. Yeah, because we're like 6 months into it with seriously no end in sight. I know many people are venturing out. And I guess, you know, to each his own. But if you're an old fart like I am, and you have some health issues, well, then you stay home. And we're staying home. I don't see any end in sight, and it's frustrating. And what's even worse, I just noticed a news item came across my desktop, and it really upset me because I'm a big Van Morrison fan. You know, going back to my high school days, Moondance was one of my favorite albums. It's still one of my, you know, desert island discs if I had to pick 10 or 12 albums to take with me. Yeah, I've got a gold record. Oh, it's not gold, actually. It's, yeah, I can't get it off the wall, but it's for, Back on Top, from my LA radio days from Van Morrison. And so I'm very upset. I read the headline with great excitement and, wonder. And because the headline reads, Van Morrison to release protest songs. And then I look closely, and it's lockdown protest songs. Really? In the lyrics, he claims scientists are, quote, making up crooked facts to justify measures that enslave the population. In another song, he says, the new normal is not normal. We were born to be free. You know, I guess even my favorite old rock stars are, you know, it can go lose their minds after a while. And as somebody on my Twitter feed just responded to my sad tweet, somebody named Jonathan Straka says, he's always been a curmudgeon. You know, I will say this, occasionally, you know, I occasionally play a little clip of a song here and there, and I used Van Morrison's Caravan from that Moondance album. You know, one goes, turn it up, a little bit higher, radio. His version is much better than mine, I promise you. Anyway, my video got blocked because I used like 10 seconds of that song. So, you know what? Screw you, Van Morrison. Damn it. God, oh, my old heroes. All right, on to other things. It's it's depressing. But it's Friday. Hey, so we got that going for us. Let's see, what I got a lot of stuff. Lisa Graves is with us today. Lisa Graves, if you've listened to this show for any amount of time, you know who Lisa Graves is. She's a friend of mine, and I am so in awe of this woman because she's brilliant and so accomplished. And on Monday of this week, Lisa Graves testified before the House Oversight Committee, the subcommittee of on government operations or something like that. Anyway, it was dealing with the post office, the U.S. Postal Service, and she was brilliant. And so all week, I was like, I got to get Lisa on. And sure enough, it's a good thing I sort of waited till today, because today there's breaking news. There's breaking news of along the Postal Service lines, and that is that. Let me get my notes up here. An appeals court judge, hold on, let me find the story, because I got to go scrolling through, you know, it's pages and pages of news today, because there's a lot of it. All right, so an appeals court judge today blocked the U.S. Postal Service and Louis DeJoy from changing any more policies or protocols ahead of November's presidential election. And it has also said that the U.S. Postal Service must undo all of the changes it's made in the last few months, including restrictions on late and extra mail trips. Well, Lisa, in her testimony before Congress on Monday, pointed out some stuff I didn't know about Louis DeJoy. How this man was ever appointed Postmaster General is beyond me. Oh, wait, it's Donald Trump's swamp. That's how it happened. It's astounding. So we'll talk to Lisa about all of that and about Bill Barr, too, because I think our country is under the control, and yes, control, of the most crooked, corrupt attorney general in U.S. history. And I'm not like the authority on American history. I'm really not. That said, let me share something with you. You know, Donald Trump has launched an attack on the New York Times 1619 Project, on education, about the real American history. And so a company, if I can find it now, because I wasn't planning on doing this, but I'm going to do it anyway, even though I'm not supposed to. There's a publisher called Seven Stories Press. And Seven Stories Press has published Howard Zinn's book. They published a People's History of the United States, which Donald Trump called out in his speech yesterday and saying, they're not going to teach Howard Zinn while I'm in charge. Instead, we're going to give you some whitewashed, you know, American history, you know, from a white person's perspective, and we're going to call it the 1776 Project. Well, you know what? Screw you, Donald Trump. So, Seven Stories Press, which is Howard Zinn's publisher, sent an email, and it says, free ebook, Howard Zinn Forever, with a little heart. Isn't that nice? And let's see, there's a graphic here. It has a quote from Howard Zinn that says, to criticize the government is the highest act of patriotism. And then Seven Stories Press writes, no to authoritarianism, no to nationalist propaganda, no to the 1776 commission. And then it says, who needs Trump's 1776 commission? Certainly not us. Students deserve more than nationalist propaganda. They deserve to learn a complete history of the United States, of the people, and for the people. To teach a people's history is to consider the historical perspective of the marginalized and the oppressed. It is to acknowledge the historical impact of people from all backgrounds, to share the groundbreaking cultural and political contributions of everyday people, not just the stories promoted by and beneficial to those in power. So, Seven Stories Press is offering, I guess, to anybody in their email list, which includes me, a free download of the book, Howard Zinn, Artists in Times of War. So, I will share this with you, you appreciator of Howard Zinn. If you want this, I will forward it to you, and you can get the free download of this book. It's only good through this weekend. The offer expires on Monday. So, if you want this free Howard Zinn ebook, Artists in Times of War, send me an email, nicole@nicolesandler.com, and I will forward you this email from Seven Stories Press. It's just one way to tell Donald Trump to go fuck himself, you know, and to shut the fuck up already.
I just need you to shut the fuck up, cause nobody asked you, bitch. I need you to shut the fuck up, bitch, shut the fuck up, bitch. Just shut the fuck up, bitch, shut the fuck up, bitch. Bow, bow, shut the fuck up, shut the fuck up, bow.
It's my new favorite song.
Shut the fuck up, shut the fuck up, bow, bow. Shut the fuck up, shut the fuck up,
bow, bow. Oh, and it ends like that. I need a musician friend of mine to give it a definite ending, you know. By the way, I don't know who that is. It's a little video that was on TikTok, and the account name with it is, now I can't read it. It's Alex, I want to say Eisenberg or something like that, but that's not it. But I've been looking for this person. I look for them on YouTube. I look for them on Twitter. Can't find them. And Donald Trump is outlawing TikTok, so go figure. Anyway, it's something that I'll continue to play because I love it. And I will give credit where credit is due when I can, when I find out who these people are behind. It's one guy, and I guess that's him, Alex somebody. Let me see if I can't read this. It's my old age. My eyesight is bad. Alex Engelberg, E-N-G-E-L-B-E-R-G. So that's the account on TikTok. I'm not a TikTok person, but I can't find his account anywhere else. But anyway, it's him singing the background, and there's a beautiful woman singing the, you know, shut the fuck up part. But, you know, anyway, it's something that I stole off the internet. And whoever you people are who did that, brilliant work. All right, we're going to get to some news. We're going to have Lisa on for an extended interview today. So I'll tell you what, let's do a quick, a very quick time out so our friends at the Progressive Voices Network can take care of some business before we move on. So let me just press this button if I can ever get this to cooperate. I wish you could see my little setup here. You know, I've been in radio for over 40 years, and everything is simple. You push a button and it fires. But in this makeshift world of, you know, studios at home, I have as professional a studio as one can have. And there's still times it just, you know, you can't just push the buttons. You got to do three things at once. So I'm trying my hardest for you, everybody. All right. We'll be right back on the Nicole Sandler Show. And I don't think it worked because I'm a doofus. All right. Either Progressive Voices is in commercials or they're not. I'll tell you what we'll do is we'll get to a little bit of news while we can. Let's do this.
I read the news today. Oh, boy.
And let's tell you what we're going to tell you about. Well, I guess we'll start with the COVID because it's still there despite our wishes to the contrary. It's still there. Global coronavirus cases have now topped 30 million, and the U.S., Brazil, and India collectively have more than half of the world's infections put together. The U.S., Brazil, and India. The death toll in the U.S., well, depending on who, what authority you listen to, has either already passed 200,000 or is just right on the cusp. But we're right there. 200,000 people in the United States alone dying of this disease that apparently Van Morrison thinks is a hoax. God. The World Health Organization is also concerned about an alarming surge of cases in Europe where lockdowns are starting again. They're trying to avoid them in the UK and Israel and a number of other places, but many European governments are imposing strict local measures and weighing further lockdowns in a bid to stop the growing second wave. In other news, we told you about this yesterday when it happened. A woman named Olivia Troy, is no longer anonymous. She's a former top Homeland Security aide to Vice President Mike Pence, and she said yesterday that she's endorsing and voting for Joe Biden because she sees Donald Trump as a weak leader who badly mismanaged the government's response to the coronavirus pandemic. Troy joined a growing number of Trump administration officials and other Republicans publicly endorsing Biden in next month's or November's election. I keep wanting to rush it. It's not just a month away. Even though today, in-person voting started in Virginia, Minnesota, South Dakota, and Wyoming. We're on our way. But anyway, back to Olivia Troy. She helped run the White House Coronavirus Task Force before stepping down last month. And, here's a little bit of her reasoning. I think. Uh-oh. Why do I have no sound there? Tell me I did this again. Why do I have nothing? That's not good. Do I have no sound anywhere on that bank? No, that worked. But Olivia Troy doesn't want to play. Oh, well. I played it yesterday, so you heard it. Anyway, let's see. One of the things she said is, if the president had taken this virus seriously, he would have saved lives. And Mike Pence, to whom she worked very closely with, he said, she never raised concerns with my staff while she was here. And she sounds like one more disgruntled employee that has decided to play politics during election year. Well, what do you expect her to do? She saw a dereliction of duty and decided to speak out about it. And for that, she deserves a medal. Seriously, she deserves to be celebrated, not criticized. But, you know, Mike Pence is going to be Mike Pence. Ugh. God, I can't wait till this election is over and these people are gone and out of our lives forever. Please, please, please. In other news, let's see. Olivia, what's her name? Olivia Troy is not the only one. The former chief of staff to Education Secretary Betsy DeVos also joined an anti-Donald Trump group being led by former White House officials. Josh Venable, whose name I've definitely heard before, he worked for DeVos in 2017 and 2018. He joined the Republican Political Alliance for Integrity and Reform as an advisor. The intention of the group that was formed just last month is to act as, quote, a cleanup crew for the Republican Party. All right, good luck with that. So, yesterday, FBI Director Christopher Wray testified before Congress that Russia is once again engaging in very active efforts to influence the 2020 presidential election and to denigrate Joe Biden. You know, we've heard these warnings before. The only people who try to downplay those warnings are Trump administration officials. But according to Christopher Wray, the director of the FBI, Russia is using social media, proxies, state media, and online journals to sow divisiveness and discord and attack Biden's campaign.
We certainly have seen very active efforts by the Russians to influence our election in 2020 through what I would call more the malign foreign influence side of things. Social media, use of proxies, state media, online journals, etc. An effort to both sow divisiveness and discord, and I think the intelligence community has assessed this publicly, primarily to denigrate Vice President Biden.
Obviously, Donald Trump is not very happy with his FBI director, Christopher Wray, but after all, he appointed him. Just saying. And by the way, also, acting DHS Secretary Chad Wolf was supposed to appear at that hearing, but he ignored the subpoena. He was subpoenaed and he said, I'm not showing up. So I think that's one of the questions we're going to have to ask Lisa Graves about. And I'll tell you what, let's not wait any longer. Let's just bring her in now, shall we? Lisa Graves, are you there? Lisa Graves is Executive Director of True North Research. They investigate the influence of dark money on public policy and our democracy. Lisa previously served as Chief Counsel for Nominations for then-Chairman and then-Ranking Member of the Senate Judiciary Committee and as the Deputy Chief of the Article III Judges Division of the Administrative Office of the U.S. Courts and as a Deputy Assistant Attorney General in the Office of Legal Policy and Policy Development at the U.S. Department of Justice under both Attorneys General Reno and Ashcroft. Lisa, those titles, there's an awful lot to put on a business card there, isn't there?
It's true. I've been very fortunate to have worked with some really wonderful people over the years and other people who I have not worked for or with, like you, Nicole. I'm happy to be on your show anytime.
Oh, I love talking to you and picking your brain because you've got so much great information for us. And over the last couple of weeks, frankly, as the Attorney General, Bill Barr, seems to be going further and further off the rails, I keep saying, I got to get Lisa back on the show because you've been the closest person to an Attorney General that I know, and I know you can give us a lot of insight into what he's doing. But then something else happened. On Monday, you testified before the House Oversight Committee's Subcommittee on Government Operations regarding what's going on at the U.S. Postal Service. And it was brilliant. I watched your opening testimony and I read your statement, which I will post on the blog at NicoleSandler.com along with today's show for people who want to see and hear more. But with all that's going on with the Postal Service, I wanted to talk to you about both of these things. And then I noticed that one of the projects you're working on there at True North Research is the Ben Franklin Project, a new initiative to defend our postal service. Tell us about the Ben Franklin Project.
Oh, yes. So we've launched this project because it's quite clear that the Postal Service is under assault, both in this near term before this election and the long term through this effort to privatize it that Charles Koch has been staking for many years and has now reached really into the Republican Party, unfortunately, to have some folks who've been trying to push that dream of Charles Koch into reality. And so the Ben Franklin Project is at benfranklinproject.com, and our hope is that we can really expand the number of people who are talking about why the Postal Service matters for our republic, for our democracy, for our lives. It's crucial to our infrastructure, and we really need it to be helmed by someone who is nonpartisan, who's a great manager, and who will really restore confidence in the Postal Service and really fight for the Postal Service to thrive, rather than trying to cut it and outsource and weaken it, in my view.
Sounds great. Now, one of the reasons I read the long intro, and by the way, I could have gone on probably for 10 more minutes on your experience, but I read off some of those titles. For instance, Chief Counsel for Nominations for the Senate Judiciary Committee. You dealt with people like a Louis DeJoy who were nominated for cabinet level positions and others that that needed to be vetted, and therefore you spoke to the idea of vetting candidates in your opening statement. Do you believe Louis DeJoy was ever vetted for his suitability for fitness to be the Postmaster General?
Well, my experience is predominantly in vetting people for positions for lifetime appointment. Wow. As judges, okay. Both for recommendation, well, for nomination, and for and for confirmation to the U.S. courts, and those are in some ways, like, these jobs, since they're for life, require very careful vetting. But what I learned in researching what was happening in the Postal Service was that the Postmaster General, that his term has no limit. He serves as long as the board of the Postal Service allows him to serve. And so it could be for life. Postmasters have served for decades.
Wow.
More than a decade, and there's no term limit. And so the idea that Louis DeJoy was approved by this board, and it's a board that now has been entirely appointed by Donald Trump. Every member on there is appointed by Trump. It's now formally bipartisan, although a majority of Republican members. It's below the number that the statute sets for Congress to have approved in terms of having congressional oversight. So it's a shorthanded, partisan-led board that has chosen the most partisan postmaster general in at least nearly 50 years to be postmaster, since the position was removed from being a cabinet position, a political appointment. The person who Donald Trump chose for the board, who's now the chairman of the board, is the right-hand man of literally the right-hand man of Mitch McConnell in fundraising for the Senate Leadership Fund to keep Mitch McConnell in power. He's someone who has helped raise tens of millions of dollars for Mitch McConnell for the Senate to remain in Republican hands, where it has rammed through all these judges, many of whom have been very poorly qualified, if not qualified to be fair at all. In this instance now, the Postal Service Board is helmed by a guy who is extraordinarily partisan, is continuing to aid Mitch McConnell, according to news accounts, in terms of the fundraising operation, and who previously worked closely with Karl Rove on Crossroads, his electoral engine or vehicle, and has worked on this man, Mike Duncan, has worked on handling entities that have huge amounts of data on American voters, and there's been some data breaches on that as well. So he himself does not have a great track record. He's not the type of person that really should be at the helm of the Postal Service Board of Governors. But Mitch McConnell and Donald Trump arranged his term appointment in terms of the sequence of his term to serve until 2025, unless he's removed. And so here you have a person who is the Postmaster General, who has a very troubling record, which I can talk to you about, but he was shepherded through the process, put on the list of people to become Postmaster General by Mike Duncan after Louis DeJoy had made substantial donations to the Republican Party to try to help Donald Trump win this election. And the board is, the other members of the board, almost all the other ones had not been there for very long. The other Senate confirmed board members who were part of this decision had only been on the board for 8 months. So they were very inexperienced in terms of what the Postal Service needs or even how to govern it. But this is the crew that was put together by Trump that put Louis DeJoy on the board, or pardon me, as the postmaster. And Louis DeJoy had previously been tapped by Donald Trump to be deputy finance chairman for the RNC alongside two of Donald Trump's closest allies, one of whom is Michael Cohen, who was a Sixer and, you know, has been convicted. Mm-hmm. And the other is a man who resigned in disgrace over hush money payments that Michael Cohen arranged for him. And so make no mistake, Louis DeJoy is a very partisan political ally of the president. He's held a fundraiser in his own home that raised more than $2 million, I think, for the president, as well as giving hundreds of thousands of dollars to the president for his campaign, you know, to the president's campaign and the RNC to try to help him win this very election.
Wow. And yes, and your testimony before the House Oversight Committee that's posted, by the way, at truenorthresearch.org. I'll link to it from my blog, but it's there should anyone want to go start reading it now because it's fascinating. You point out a lot of red flags. For instance, one of the things is that, as you mentioned, he made a dramatic increase in his political donations right before it was made known that he was interested in becoming Postmaster General. So, the timing is suspect. You also talk about, in something that we've known, that he's got financial conflicts of interest based on this company, XPO Logistics, that he no longer owns, but he still has a share in it. And he's able to contract out work from the post office to them, right? I mean, he's still in a position to make money based off of his association there, isn't he?
Well, yeah. I mean, the short answer to that is that he has tens of millions of dollars of stock in XPO, even though he no longer controls XPO as a fiduciary matter in terms of as a leader. But he benefits from XPO benefiting, and a New York Times report from about a week ago showed that XPO had an increase in contracts this summer over the previous summer. XPO has said that it doesn't have any contact with DeJoy, but it doesn't have to have contact with DeJoy for DeJoy to benefit from it benefiting. And so one of the people at the hearing, actually two of them at the hearing, who previously served in a role of ethics reviews, one of whom was directly in that role, said that they would never have allowed someone who had that kind of conflict of interest to be in charge of an agency. That was Richard Painter, who was formerly George W. Bush's ethics reviewer, and said that this was a no-go. You just can't have someone who has substantial holdings in a business that does business with the agency you're in charge of. You can say that you're not making decisions about that business, but your decisions obviously affect that business in which you have substantial stock. And so it's a huge conflict, and that itself would also, I think, should have been disqualifying.
Should have been being the operative term there. Richard Painter, by the way, yes, also testified on Monday, as you did, before the House Oversight Committee. You also told about family problems. DeJoy's brother accused him of forging his signature and hiding profitable companies from him. This is sleazy.
Well, it was astonishing to see that litigation. This was a case that was filed by one of his brothers against him, and his brother alleged, you know, in this complaint, this was a complaint that he had to swear to, that Louis DeJoy had created bank accounts in his name at Bank One, at BBT, and at another investment firm, and that there were millions of dollars in those accounts, that the brother didn't know anything about the accounts because Louis DeJoy had had his mail intercepted so that he didn't see the bank statements for more than 5 years, and that he only discovered the existence of those accounts after they'd been in existence for more than 5 years, and that he alleged in that complaint that he had been defrauded out of millions of the family business that he thought was to be shared equally among these three brothers, and in fact he had been cut out of companies that he thought were subsidiaries, because the primary family company was described as a parent company, but the subsidiaries weren't subsidiaries. They were separate companies in which Louis DeJoy held the majority control. Louis DeJoy denied all the allegations of his brother. The lawsuit went on for a number of months and finally settled with a secrecy agreement. So we don't know the ultimate outcome. But what I would say to you is I have never heard ever of any person in the role of Postmaster General being accused by anyone of stealing their mail or hiding their mail.
Right,
or
mail fraud.
Mail. A fraud and of deceit, of a pattern of deception. And obviously he denies it, but that raises huge warning flags about the person who is now at the helm of deciding how our elections are going to be handled in terms of vote by mail.
Right.
And so the question I posed was, if Louis DeJoy's brother, you know, couldn't trust him to not hide his mail from him and millions of dollars, how can the American people trust Louis DeJoy with millions of our votes?
Right. And I mean, just on that alone, you can't, if I want to hand out flyers around my neighborhood, I can put them under somebody's door, but I can't put a flyer in someone's mailbox. You don't fuck with people's mail. That's a felony. Louis DeJoy could be prosecuted for this, couldn't he?
Well, it depends on the jurisdiction. In essence, in theory, in North Carolina, the statute of limitations rules are easier. This conduct would have occurred between 1995, 96, 97, 98, 99. So it's been some time. It'd be hard to prosecute that long ago. However, the claims are extraordinary and very troubling. And if the case had been referred to a prosecutor at that time that the complaint was filed before it was settled in 2001, if it were proven mail fraud or mail theft or taking someone else's mail, is a felony and is subject to a potential 5-year prison sentence as well as to a substantial fine. And, you know, the cases are prosecuted when people remove mail from someone else's post box. Like you said, you can't put something in someone's post box and you can't take something out of it. In this instance, what the brother alleged was that the bank statements were coming to their place of work in his name and they were hidden from him. They were intercepted before they would get to his desk with his other mail.
Oh, my. You don't do that. And this man is now Postmaster General. It was interesting because one time when he was testifying before a House committee just a couple of weeks ago, he was asked in a very tough line of questioning about political contributions that his employees made and that he reimbursed them for. These charges just resurfaced again that this is something that has happened. Let me play this clip from, it was August 24th when DeJoy testified that he had never done this. And listen to the almost sanctimonious tone in his voice, like, how dare you even ask me this question?
Well, Mr. DeJoy, as a mega donor for the Trump campaign, you were picked along with Michael Cohen and Elliot Broidy, two men who have already pled guilty to felonies, to be the three deputy finance chairmen of the Republican National Committee. Did you pay back several of your top executives for contributing to Trump's campaign by bonusing or rewarding them?
That's an outrageous claim, sir, and I resent it.
I'm just asking a question.
The answer is no.
So you did not bonus or reward any of your executives?
No.
Or anyone that you solicited for a contribution to the Trump campaign?
No, sir.
Not in whole or in part?
To be, during the Trump campaign, I wasn't even working at my company anymore.
Well, we want to make sure that campaign contributions are legal, so all your campaign
I'm fully aware of legal campaign contributions.
Well, what if
I resent the assertion, sir? What are you accusing me of?
Well, I'm asking a question.
He resents the assertion, yet we've heard it from former employees that Louis DeJoy had them make political contributions for which they were reimbursed. That's now lying under oath, isn't it?
Well, you know, I want to also review the all the exchanges. I did look at them before, and I asked for the Congress to make a referral to the U.S. Attorney's Office because the evidence, in essence, that was presented in the Washington Post story, which is statements by former employees by name, mm-hmm. as well as some who were unnamed, what they said was that, in fact, they were pressured to give to political campaigns. They didn't specify exactly which of those campaigns they were pressured on, but a number of those political campaigns. And what the Post found was that a number of employees gave when Louis DeJoy was leading the company. And then as soon as Louis DeJoy left the company, they stopped making those donations, which is a sign that they were pressured to do so. Some of those employees said on the record, including a significant employee of that company, that other employees were reimbursed through bonuses for their political giving. And so it appears that it appears from the Washington Post story that it may have been a number of political campaigns that where people were pressured to give right. and then were rewarded for giving, which is potentially multiple counts of creating a straw donor situation and having a corporation that you control reimburse or partially reimburse those donors for making donations to the candidates that you prefer.
Right. But he was so offended by the question. I mean, his posturing there was just infuriating. So,
well, yeah, I mean, and it certainly looks like to me there is evidence of using this sort of straw donor scheme. Mm-hmm. You know, prosecutor would have to look at which campaigns that was involved in. But quite frankly, that's a third rail issue. You know, you cannot reimburse your employees for their political donations. Corporations cannot give directly to campaigns, federal campaigns, and in most states, state campaigns. And it's actually been illegal under federal law since like 1907.
Wow.
For corporations to give money to campaigns. So you can't game the system and basically urge your employees to give donations and then reward them for doing so. Without violating those laws. And so, you know, this question is another troubling factor in the history of Louis DeJoy. And it really raises the question that you began with, which is whether anyone on that board did any vetting of Louis DeJoy before he was moved forward, given right. this array of conflicts, of potentially disqualifying behavior. And also, I would point out that there was a substantial news story that interviewed a number of employees at the warehouses where his employees were handling the logistics operation, the delivery operations. And he was notorious for refusing to turn the air conditioning on in North Carolina summer heat.
Oh my God.
In order to save money for his own profits, basically, which is almost the definition of a sweatshop.
Yeah.
That North Carolina heat is a little less hot than Florida heat.
Right. But it's still pretty damn
not
hot.
Not by much.
No.
Yeah.
And Lisa Graves, of course, this story, Louis DeJoy, is in the news today because we learned this morning that Judge Stanley Bastian ruled that basically any changes that Louis DeJoy has made at the Postal Service must stop now. And any changes that have been made in the last few months need to be undone, reversed. I mean, most of us, let me speak for myself. I never heard of Louis DeJoy until the story started emerging about the Postal Service slowing down, about them removing these high-speed mail sorting machines and them taking away, removing the mail collection boxes from the streets. And now 14 states accused Donald Trump and Louis DeJoy of trying to slow down deliveries to thwart mail-in voting. This federal judge today blocked the Postal Service and DeJoy from changing policies or protocols before the election now, and again, reversing the changes they've already made. This is a big deal, isn't it?
It really is, and I think that, you know, this situation, it bears repeating because, you know, people were getting their mail delivered on time. There was not a surge of complaints. You can see the data, and Congress has put that data in the record. The House of Representatives, Democrats have data from the Postal Service of the fact that the slowdown began after Louis DeJoy became the head of the Postal Service. So right. this spring, as the coronavirus was raging through New York, was beginning to take hold in our country, people were not experiencing their delays, but as soon as this man gets in charge and starts making changes to the Postal Service operations, suddenly there's a dramatic slowdown of 7 to 10% slowdown in the mail, which, you know, you may think, oh, well, that's pretty good. That's like 90% on time. No. Well, 7 to 10%, if you're processing hundreds of millions of pieces of mail a day, accumulates to hundreds of millions of pieces of mail, millions of pieces of mail every day being late, not by necessarily one day, but 2 days or 3 days. There was a terrible story in terms of the revelations out of the Los Angeles Times that talked about the number of animals that died.
Yes.
Like chicks that were, that had been transferred to the mail consistently for, you know, years, always arriving on time or, you know, almost always arriving on time, died because the mail was backed up because of his policies, his policy changes. And one of those includes this very, I would say, mislabeled description of what he did. He issued an order that the postal trucks were supposed to, quote, leave on time. And then he bragged in August as the slowdown was happening that he had improved the numbers of the number of trucks leaving on time. Well, they're leaving without all
the
mail.
Empty, right. They were leaving empty, like, but they left.
Yeah, nothing to brag about. It's the wrong metric. When, in fact, in that same article, he talks about how there was a consequence to, quote, the services delivered. Yeah, the mail being delivered. And so you have a person who's basically bragging about forcing the trucks to leave, whether the mail is sorted or not, and also dictating where the mail trucks can even park, which is extraordinary micromanagement. And the effect of that, combined with the removal of these sorting machines, every year sorting machines are removed due to obsolescence or changes in processes, but it's been documented now that the number of mail machines removed since June, mid-June, was 711 mail sorting machines. And in the prior 4 years, the number removed on average annually was 380 some machines. And so almost twice as many machines were removed in basically a 2 month period, just as he's also putting in new restrictions on overtime, or his team is on his behalf, limiting access to overtime, which has been helping postal service workers make sure our mail got delivered on time. And then on top of that, you have this get the mail trucks out, even if the mail isn't sorted, let it accumulate.
Right.
Leave the mail behind. And if you think about the mail, I suppose, like your dishes, if you don't do the dishes one day, maybe you do half of them. Yeah. You have half of them, and then the next day's dishes. And then if you do half again, you've got a full day's dishes plus the next half day. It just accumulates. And this is on a millions of pieces basis nationwide.
Right, right.
And so it's a disaster for someone like that. And what I said to Congress was, if he were a probationary employee, he would have been fired already.
That's right.
Fired.
That's right. As he should be. The other thing that the judge, Judge Bastian, noted was that 72% of those high-speed sorting machines decommissioned were in counties that Hillary Clinton won in 2016.
Yeah, I mean, that was an extraordinary finding. And, you know, the notion that in essence, if you think about what that means on a more macro basis, those are cities, right?
Yep.
So machines in cities that have the highest density of population, that's where the machines are being removed from, near from. I mean, that is an extraordinary, you know, that looks and smells terrible. It certainly seems to really back up the judge's ruling that the Postmaster General is using his power to influence this election.
Yes. So, Lisa Graves, when you testified, you called for him to resign. And if he's not going to resign, you called for him to be fired. What happens now? Obviously, there's lots of evidence that this guy is shady, and I'm being generous here. What do we do?
Well, we have to keep calling on him to be fired or to resign. And even though I know that Board of Governors has been stacked by Trump, they should be hearing from everyone about the fact that this man should not be in this position of power in our postal service. And members of Congress need to hear that. And also talking to your local postmaster, calling your local post office, telling him or her what you think, that you want the postal service to be supported, to be led by a nonpartisan person devoted to protecting the mail, not a partisan, a political person with such a background like Louis DeJoy in terms of how he's treated employees and the like. You know, people need to just keep raising the alarm bells about this guy, because he's in power until he's not. And this is a crisis in our democracy to have someone like Louis DeJoy, such a partisan, pushed through by another partisan who's close, super close with Mitch McConnell, to helm our postal service at this time in our country. It wouldn't be appropriate at any time, but on the eve of an election and in the middle of a pandemic when people are going to be relying on vote by mail, it is truly outrageous for there to be such a partisan person like like Louis DeJoy in a position of power and having done the damage he's already done to the Postal Service and to the American people.
Absolutely. All right. So we all need to be vocal and speak out because this can't be allowed to continue on. Thank goodness for this judge who said no more changes and put everything back. I don't know that they can put things back because I know they destroyed some of those machines, but at least it's a move in the right direction and telling them to stop. What galls me on top of all this other stuff is DeJoy insists he doesn't know who gave the order to take down those machines, but because it wasn't him. So wait, really? Yeah. You come in, you're the new Postmaster General, somebody you don't know who ordered to take these machines out. You don't know why, but you're going to say, go ahead anyway.
Well, no, the other part of it that I would just say that is that I find, I suppose, more galling is he affirmatively told Congress belligerently that he would not allow those machines to be reinstalled.
Come back. Right.
So, you know, tell me about how it's not your decision, but you're refusing to allow the machines to be reinstalled or repaired.
Yep.
The ones whose lines were severed in the dark of night, the machines that were dismantled and thrown out behind post office sorting facilities.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he has belligerently refused to order that those machines be restored.
Yeah.
And that, you know, I think is also a sign of his disingenuousness.
I think you're right. Hey, Lisa Graves, we've spent a lot of time on Louis DeJoy, and obviously for good reason. It's very important. The questions surrounding Bill Barr are just astounding to me. So I started, as I was waiting to connect with you, I started writing down just from memory a list of some of the heinous things that Bill Barr has said or done. And here's what I came up with just, you know, in 2 minutes off the top of my head. Interfered in sentencing for Roger Stone. Tried to get Michael Flynn case dismissed. Misrepresented to the American public what's in the Mueller report. Reportedly told prosecutors to consider charging protesters with sedition. Asked prosecutors about criminal charges against the mayor of Seattle for allowing protesters that police free zone for a week. He took over Trump's personal defense against a libel suit brought by E. Jean Carroll, who accused Trump of raping her. Played dumb about it being illegal to vote more than once in any state. Compared the coronavirus lockdown to slavery. Disparaged Black Lives Matter, saying they don't care about black lives but only props. And that was just really off the top of my head in one stream of consciousness. It goes on. There's more. This man is horrendous. And I think in some cases, even worse than Trump, because he knows better. What do you think of Bill Barr, somebody who has worked as an assistant deputy attorney general?
Well, I think he's brought dishonor to the U.S. Department of Justice, and it's a disgrace. I think that if there were any justice, he would be impeached. Any real justice in America at this time, if there were a Senate that was not beholden to Trump, as Mitch McConnell's Senate is, Bill Barr would not be sitting in the office of Attorney General. He has misused his office. He's directed law enforcement to basically, law enforcement officers, including prosecutors, to basically advance the political agenda of Donald Trump. He's politicized the department. He has brought shame on the department in many ways that you enumerate, including how they've handled the plea bargain with Michael Flynn, this most recent effort to try to assert that the Justice Department needs to be defending Donald Trump in that libel suit involving
Amazing.
The woman who said that he raped her.
Yep.
It is it's a true scandal, and I never thought that I would see a day like this with such a disreputable person leading the Justice Department. I hope that ultimately he's disbarred. I think that he is unfit to be an attorney and being giving legal advice at the helm of the Justice Department, given the fact that he has tried to use the law in these ways to try to advance the president's agenda. And even this notion that protesters should be charged with sedition, while in the White House sits a man who was actively urging insurrection against governors for daring to follow health guidance
Yep.
about people sheltering in place during as this pandemic rose, while Barr sat silent. And his comments about the staff of the Justice Department are offensive.
Oh my!
His views, his attacks on voting rights, and the just the sleazy way he's answered questions about voting rights and the statements of the president, it's unconscionable and unethical. And it's a dark day in this country that we have a man like Bill Barr at the helm of the Justice Department. I look forward to the day when he is removed from that office and hopefully somehow barred from ever serving in a position as a public servant ever again.
Thank you. Thank you for saying all that. As an attorney, I mean, does it freak you out? Does it, it's got to bother you, because it does me, that these people are seemingly untouchable. Bill Barr is still sitting there heading up the Department of Justice. Louis DeJoy is still Postmaster General. And, oh God, what, something just happened the other day that made my head explode. It's just one thing after another. Oh, I know what it was. Chad Wolf, the acting secretary of the Department of Homeland Security, was subpoenaed to testify yesterday at the Homeland Security hearing. He defied the subpoena. He said, I'm not showing up. And there's nothing that can be done. What happened to our system of checks and balances? I thought that the House had powers of inherent contempt. If someone openly defies a subpoena, I thought they could send out the sergeant at arms or whoever it is to arrest them. Can't we do anything?
We now have a situation in which a court has also ruled to limit the ability of Congress to get witnesses to come before it. And so we have an assault on the rule of law. Meanwhile, Trump tweets in capital letters about the rule of law when he defies it on a regular basis and calls for it to be violated, in essence, on a regular basis. And where he has an attorney general who is basically acting as his personal attorney and enabling him rather than telling him what he cannot or should not do based on the advice of the Department of Justice and the history of these practices, including just the multiple violations of the Hatch Act that have been occurring on White House property, using White House property, using the people's property, using appointees to basically violate the Hatch Act live on, you know, prime TV.
Yep.
And so you have basically a contempt for the rule of law, at least as it applies to this administration, to Donald Trump, and others. And then you have this effort to try to use the law in these extraordinary ways to try to punish a mayor of a city who's trying to deal with how to calm a situation and handle a situation in the case of Portland, threatening to put troops on the street, and in fact sending unmarked troops, basically troops without name badges, into the city of Portland, as well as there were the men who were surrounding the Justice Department.
That's
right. Who didn't have any insignia of which branch of the military or of the Justice Department or the Bureau of Prisons or of whatever that they were responsible for, with no names, so that if they harmed someone, you couldn't report who they had harmed. You have this attorney general striding across the Lafayette Square Park that's been cleared so that the president can hold up a Bible in front of a church for a photo op. Yep. And we just heard within the last 24 to 48 hours that the military operation that was deployed to clear the park thought about using a heat ray machine on American citizens in front of the White House. And so things are off the rails. And that's, I think, why people need to do everything they can to try to defend our democracy, try to make sure that their right to vote is protected, have a plan to vote, make sure you vote your conscience, and try. I hope people will stand up for the actual rule of law. This is, I would say, in my personal capacity to you, Nicole, our democracy is at risk like it's never been in more than 200 years with a person like Donald Trump, who is spiteful of the rule of law in this country and contemptuous of it. And, everyone has to decide who they're going to vote for, how they're going to vote with their own conscience. But I just would say to you that, in fact, our democracy is hanging in the balance, given the fact that we do not have adequate checks and balances on a person who has behaved with such disregard for basic rules and customs and traditions and understandings about the role of the president and the role of a political party and the role of a campaign, in addition to all the other ways in which he has transgressed our basic rules in our democracy, including challenging whether he's even going to accept the results of this election and trying to set up a completely outrageous premise that the only way he can lose is by fraud and he wins if otherwise he's a winner. Basically, he's a winner no matter what happens. We've never had such despotic, autocratic thinking and acting, not even from Richard Nixon.
Right. It's never happened before. And so I know I've kept you too long, Lisa. Last question. When, hopefully, we come out in such huge numbers that it can't be denied that we send Donald Trump packing in a landslide, please, do we need to reset certain laws? Like you alluded to it, an appeals court, it was regarding Don McGahn, the former White House counsel, who also defied a subpoena, who this appeals court said, well, yeah, the Constitution allows for him to be subpoenaed, but there's no mechanism to enforce the subpoena. Seriously? So do we need to codify all that stuff? We need to put mechanisms in for checks and balances, that the House has oversight capability and responsibility, that do we need to spell every little thing out? Apparently we do.
I think we're going to need, at the next available opportunity, substantial reforms that Congress is going to have to pass, and hopefully a president will sign into law that really do protect these institutions, the institutions of our democracy, their powers of oversight, the rights of the people to access information, the rights of the people to have the laws enforced on anyone in power, including the president, and to reinforce the fundamental American principle that a president is not king, mm-hmm. and no person is above the law in America. Unfortunately, right now, there is someone above the law in America, and it's Donald Trump, and that is completely contrary to our entire system of government.
Yeah, it is astounding. Do you ever in a million years think we'd ever be here?
No, you know, and I can't even believe that I'm missing that Senator Sessions was Attorney General. Who knew?
Right.
Who knew?
Right.
We would be in so much better hands with Sessions.
Sessions.
With all his flaws.
Right.
All his deep flaws.
It's astounding. I call it opposite world. It is.
Yep.
Left is right, up is down. And hopefully we can get back to some semblance of normal, and then we can take on Joe Biden. Lisa Graves.
Well, I'm heartened by the fact that there's bipartisan support for the rule of law. And so maybe this period is really waking people up to the necessity of defending the institutions of our democracy.
I certainly
hope so. And
making
them better.
I certainly hope so. Lisa Graves, always a pleasure. Thank you so much for sharing your brilliance with us. I couldn't ask for anything more.
Thank you for your questions.
So appreciate it. Thank you, Lisa. Check out truenorthresearch.org. Find Lisa on the Twitters at TheLisaGraves. And, of course, here whenever I can talk her into coming on. Thank you, Lisa. We'll talk soon.
Thanks, Nicole.
Lisa Graves, she's so smart, and she's so good, and she's just... I'm thankful she's my friend, and I'm even more grateful that she comes on this show to talk to all of us, because she said a lot of stuff we need to hear. So I'm going to post her testimony in written form from what she said in front of the House Oversight Committee on Monday on the blog, where I post the podcast of each day's show. Today will be at NicoleSandler.com/9-18-20, because today is the 18th. You see how that works. All right. And with that, we're at the end of another week. Oh, yeah. And I always feel a sense of relief. I'm not quite sure why. It's just sort of another day ending in a Y. But yeah, we have 2 days to regroup and and then do it all over again. I hope you stay safe. Listen to some great music this weekend. Maybe not Van Morrison. Or listen to some of his old stuff. I just found another tweet where somebody posted some of these lyrics, and as somebody else wrote, let me read, because I can't paraphrase it. The lyrics are not even amateurish; they're just brutally bad. Here, no more lockdown, no more government overreach, no more fascist bullies disturbing our peace. No more taking of our freedom and our God-given rights, pretending it's for our safety when it's really to enslave. Who's running our country? Who's running our world? Examine it closely and watch it unfurl. Are you kidding me? Stick with Brown-Eyed Girl or something like that. Sorry, Van Morrison jumped the shark. Guess that's what happens sometimes when you are curmudgeonish. All right. I'm bitching about nothing. Time for me to take my leave and have a weekend. Have a great one. Stay safe. Stay in if you can. You know, all those usual warnings. And come back on Monday. I'm not sure what we'll do Monday, but we'll do something on Monday, okay? All right. I will see you back here then. Have a great weekend, everyone. Bye.